I'm here again after the opening, and this time I want to moderate the panel. This is the fourth panel that we have this, in this conference, and relates to philanthropy. So to cut the time, because we are very late, and so I assume that all appreciate to be very timely. All my panelists are already there, so I want to introduce them, and then to introduce the argument that we are going to touch with some question to them. So we have on the stage Monica Heslington, from Goldman Sachs. She's the Vice President, Head of Goldman Sachs Family Office, Art and Collectible Advisory. And then in alphabetical sequence, Simone Bemporad, Group Chief Communication and Public Affairs Officer of Assicurazioni Generali, Peter Goes from Stich in de Vere Bergen In-House Counsel, Mikolaj Sekutowicz is the co-founder and CEO of Therme Art, and Marco Trevisan, the director of the Alberto Peruzzo Foundation. So as you can see, the topics that you are going to touch is philanthropy. So we are linked to something that we touched at the very beginning in terms of new frontiers of art in a world that is changing and in which the corporate social responsibility is assuming new importance because it is no more the time to talk about that, but it is the time to measure it with the ESG, and the component S, social, is probably the most linked to philanthropical activities. So now we are approaching a time in which philanthropy could not be seen anymore like something that it is connected to a good behavior, to a intention, a positive intention. It is possible that we mix certain activity with the aim to obtain some advantage in terms of ranking and qualification from an ESG standpoint. So it is very important now to start to understand who is working and approaching to philanthropy on its original essence, and who is approaching to catch the ESG rating. From this point of view, obviously, we remain to what we have discussed at the very beginning with the first panel, in which the methodology for measuring the impact of an investment is the most important in order to understand if we are only talking about or if we are really impacting with an activity. And respect to this, on social S, there is a big problem now because there is no metrics already available. So while there are metrics in E, there are no metrics in S, and there are no metrics in G. But there are already banks and there are already investors that select their investment based on a supposed ESG ranking that is impossible to measure. And so the problem that we have is to talk about what is the future of the philanthropy in a world that is changing, and that it is in this moment not precisely measurable, but surely relevant from a reputational perspective. So we decided all together to approach this argument based on two questions that will be common for all the panelists, in a way that you have the possibility to see their point of view and then to make some consideration. So the first, for sake of time and for conscious of the time, I don't want to go into the profile of each of them, because it is a long profile. They are really reputable. but you find them in the QR code that we have distributed at the very beginning. But I asked to them in the first question to describe what they are doing with their organization or in advising or in exercising philanthropy, and explain to us the first what is their present view of the philanthropical activity that they are advising or executing. I would like to open with Monica and then to go ahead in a way that you prefer.
Hey, thank you.
But Monica is the first.
Obviously. Yes, thank you. Ladies first. I'm glad that chivalry still exists. So I sit at Goldman Sachs. Obviously, we are most well known for our investment banking activities, but we also have a very robust private wealth management group that we have been rapidly expanding in Europe and in the Middle East the last few years. I sit within the Goldman Sachs Family Office, and that is a group that helps our high net worth clients think about all of the non-investment related issues that concern them. So that includes income taxation, trust estate succession planning, philanthropy, cybersecurity, private aviation, art and collectibles, anything that you can imagine. We embrace a very holistic approach to wealth management. And my specific role is leading our art and collectibles advisory. So we help high net worth clients around the globe at every stage of their collecting, whether it's the acquisitions, logistics, sales, again, taxation, philanthropy, trust estate, and succession planning. Our clients are very philanthropically inclined. We just happened to have a client philanthropy forum in New York last week. We had over 200 attendees. Their collective net worth was about $72 billion, and most of them are actually on boards, active philanthropic boards. So with respect to what I see going on with art philanthropy specifically, historically the approaches that I saw most often were a collector philanthropist deciding to donate their entire collection or certain pieces to museums. I also would see people creating their own private museums or some type of an organization that would lend the collection to various museums or art institutions. However, I would say within the last couple of years, I have definitely seen a shift, particularly towards with our American clients, who tend to represent some of the largest collectors in the world. And what they are choosing to do now is actually sell their collections and then use the proceeds to fund their different philanthropic endeavors. We've seen this just this last year, just some examples. Agnes Gund, very prominent American philanthropist and collector, she just announced she will be selling one of her Liechtenstein paintings. It's estimated to sell between $3 and $5 million. All the proceeds will go for abortion rights in the US. We've seen at auction earlier this year, the Amman Foundation from Switzerland, they sold that Warhol Maryland for almost $200 million in addition to other works of art, and all of those proceeds went to charity. The same with the Anne and Gordon Getty collection that just sold for almost $80 million last week at Christie's. And then in November, we're going to have Paul Allen's collection at Christie's, which is expected to fetch around $1 billion. Impressive. So I think three reasons for this shift that I see. I think the first is that not all collectors have works of art that museums actually want to have. Museum curators are very, they're in the driver's seat, so to speak. They have very specific pieces that they want, and they might not want your Monet, but they would definitely love to have a check for the value of your Monet. They will take that, no problem. And so many collectors have realized it's a lot more difficult and time-consuming to find a museum to accept a donation of art. I would say for people who are interested in perhaps setting up their own private museums, again, not every collection in terms of quality and scope really lends itself to being a museum that people would actually want to come and see. And it also is a very costly and time-consuming endeavor. So again, people often prefer to just sell the art. But I think what's really driving this is just the astronomical prices that we are seeing for certain types of art. And so what's happening is that these collector philanthropists are actually pausing and saying, okay, I could give my art to a museum, or I could set up my own museum, but if I sell, I could have tens of millions, or maybe hundreds of millions, or if you're Paul Allen, $1 billion, and let's not kid ourselves, that is a lot of money. And I could actually probably get more impact using that money to fund certain social causes and philanthropic causes. So I'll leave my comments there. Yeah.
Thank you. So Simone Bemporad, maybe you can go with your view on this.
So to answer the question, I will briefly describe what Assicurazioni Generali is. It's an insurance and asset management company. It's the largest in Europe and one of the largest in the world. Founded in Venice in 1831, and we share with the city of Venice the winged lion of St. Mark. So when I asked myself why I was invited here, then I saw the location, St. Augustine, St. Mark, I thought that was the connection, but I think there is more to it to discuss today. So having such an heritage, Generali is strongly related to culture and heritage, especially when it comes to real estate. It's the largest real estate company in Italy, after the church, just to underscore, given the connection. And many of these buildings have a huge historical impact, so maybe we will discuss later how we see the connection between these and the role of Generali. You mentioned the ESG. What we realized in the last years is that the challenges of the world that usually people expect the government to address are now clearly not up to the government to resolve by themselves. So there is a clear call, which is not derived by, you know, being good or having a regulator behind your back that is pushing you in a certain direction, but it is clear that there are challenges that can only be met if private, both at individual and corporate level, become part of the solution. And of course, this has to be aligned with the business purpose of the company, which is obviously to ultimately make profit, when profit means creation of work, expansion of the market, innovation, and so on. And profit is a good measure of that. So when you have to do that, that requires a huge cultural transformation in the organization to understand that it's not about doing something good while you make money. It's actually trying to make money doing good for the society. Also because the prosperity in the long term of the society is the only condition that allows a business to thrive, to prosper. So what we're doing at Generali is to remodel our business, which is basically, I know that in order to explain insurance you need a book like this, but I will try to do that in 15 seconds, which is basically taking the money of the customer, taking care of this money while they are in our hands, and then give the money back to the customer when the time comes, whether because there has been a damage to property or whether because it's time to invest savings. So this is how I summarize the book like this. I think I'm quite good at that. And while we do that, of course, the drivers of our activity is investment, so how we invest our customers' money, and what kind of product we sell to our customers. So what we're doing today is to review the entire way we invest money under a social lens. So are we investing money in assets that are compliant with the SDG and SDG criteria and so on? On the other hand, when we sell product, and we're starting doing that in a number of countries, especially in Asia, but also in Italy and starting from other countries, we are including in the way we design products a social effect that can go from fostering education, supporting vulnerable families or people in vulnerable conditions, and making this a part of our commercial offer. So now what we are doing this more in a philanthropic way, and we're doing this through our foundation, which is called the Human Safety Net. Maybe I can discuss that again later when we connect this point to the real estate part. But what we are trying to do is to make sure that there is a commercial aspect in supporting people. So to make sure that joining a private approach and a public approach, private resources and public resources, everything we do can have an effect beyond the key customer, enlarging the base of customers, and making sure that we can affect also those that are not necessarily, let's say, primary customers, so the customers that are traditionally the customers of Generali. And so this is a big effort, requires a big cultural transformation, and I want to stop and discuss later more in details how art comes into play. We do that because, of course, number one, in our private and wealth management, we have a number of customers that are increasingly, that of course invest in art, and are increasingly interested in making sure that the provider of the services, of their services, is active in certain activities. The other part is to really change the culture of the company. And in order to do that, the most important direction is, the most important elements are relevance and participation. Relevance meaning we have to do something that is important, that matters. And the participation, we want to do something that involves the people of Generali, which are significant numbers, because 70,000 employees, 150,000 agents, and over 60 million customers. So participation of all these entities to this movement is what we're trying to do. So it's a massive effort that is ongoing and that we, of course, we report about. We're at the beginning, I would say, of this process. But the good news is that this is a direction that is not going to change. This is a direction there to stay.
Thank you. So Peter, it's to you.
Yes, I'm sort of humbled by being here because I'm just a clerk at a philanthropic institution. The one called mentioned just a minute ago was Stichting de Verbergen. Stichting is Dutch for foundation, but I'm here because I'm also in-house counsel for Stichting Droom en Daad, Dream and Action. It's a famous a poem. In the Netherlands. What we do is we concentrate purely on the city of Rotterdam. It's where the family that originally founded our foundations earned their money. They were the former owners of the Holland America line, transformed into an investment company, and have been very, very successful as an investment company. And they want to give something back to Rotterdam. So what we are trying to do with Stichting Droom en Daad is contribute to a beautiful and attractive Rotterdam. And Droom en Daad concentrates on art, and the Stichting de Verbergen concentrates on social programs. So why I'm there? Well, I'm a retired commercial lawyer, and I'm still young enough to work a bit, so that's why I'm there. And why I'm here is because I'm a very nasty client of Deloitte. I negotiate very harsh on fees because I think every euro of the fees I pay to any advisor need to go to the people in Rotterdam and not to the advisors. And so this is payback time. Earlier today, Dr. Martin told us about the experiences in Switzerland during the COVID, and two things struck me. One was we need to improve the working conditions of the artists, and the other one, we need to create access for everyone. Now, I can assure you that we fulfill those, because what we did during COVID was we opened a booth, a loquette, for every artist based in Rotterdam, who could then send in a project and then earn 2,500 euros, which is a lot of money for an individual artist. And why individual artists? Because the big institutions got their subsidies from the government, whatever, COVID, yes or no. Yes, they forfeited some income from visitors, but the individual artists didn't get that. So that's what we did. And now we have, I think, hundreds of projects. We didn't really look at them. So that was one on creating better working conditions. The other one is that we are helping to invest in artists' spaces. Real estate is a big issue, not only in the Netherlands, in Luxembourg for especially. Very expensive, and that means that renting a artist space is too expensive. So what we do, we buy up real estate, or we finance another foundation, which is partially the municipality, to buy up spaces, and so that they can rent out at a normal price to artists. So that's working conditions we're trying to improve. Now, access to all, two projects I'm working on. One is the building of a museum, based on of relating to immigration as former owners of the Holland America line. That's sort of the connection. So we bought a warehouse in the Rotterdam Harbor. We're refurbishing it with one of the most famous international architects, Ma Yong Song, a Chinese architect. I did the contract. I've also spent some time in Beijing. I just said sign the offer, that's fine. And then the other one is that we have negotiated with the municipality a public-private partnership in order to improve a park in Rotterdam. The park is called The Park. If you go to Brussels, you have a hotel, which is called The Hotel. If you go to the restaurant in that hotel, it's called The Restaurant and The Bar. No, but this is The Park. So it took me 3 years to negotiate with the municipality. And the issue there is that it's very difficult for a government, a local government in this situation, to let go part of their public space. Our example is the Central Park Conservancy, where you have the similar system. We are much smaller in Rotterdam, not as much money, but it took a lot of time, and that's where we can help the community in Rotterdam. So that's the work we do. We're venture philanthropists, so we don't only donate money. If you get money from us, you also get Peter Goes, which means that we try to improve governance. We try to improve compliance. Compliance is a big issue. KYC, it's very difficult to open a bank account as an artist or as a foundation in the Netherlands. So that's why we try to improve the situation in Rotterdam regarding art and culture.
Now we go to Mikolaj.
Thank you very much. My name is Mikolaj Sekutowicz. We are coming actually from the real estate sector. We are a big urban developer. We started actually in 98 in Germany as a company that was building the biggest thermal baths, and we developed into a company that is redesigning city from the ESG perspective, because it's actually measurable, so you can measure the S factor in ESG, because the city, how it is created today, is making us sick. It's a very, very non-human specific environment. We have removed all the other, animals and trees, so we don't have cohabitation, and we can measure the consequences of the city, how we have created it. And while we were moving with our company from creating vacation destinations outside of cities into the city center, we just signed the lease of Ontario's Place. It's the Central Park of Toronto for 100 years after we won the RFP, so it's a very big billion basically project that will create a new well-being city center for the Torontonians. They will also be able to see the skyline of their city the first time from a place where they can spend time during the winter without freezing, and being outdoor. So outdoor while indoor, while heated, in a kind of botanical garden surrounding. So when we moved into the city center, we needed to invest in art and culture, because art and culture is something that you want to have in the city center. And we started to have a strong philanthropic activity. So we became the main sponsor of the British Pavilion during the Venice Biennale. Then we started to finance other Biennale projects. Then we became the main sponsor of the Serpentine Gallery's Art and Architecture Program, together with Goldman Sachs. It was actually our predecessor many, many years before us. But we started to buy the pavilions to integrate them also in our urban development solutions, whereby the pavilion becomes an attraction that people basically are interested to see and to visit, and it becomes an afterlife. But while doing this kind of philanthropic engagement, we found out that actually this is very profitable. So it was a little bit difficult for us because suddenly what was meant to our Therme art program, it was meant to be a very philanthropic program, created real profits because the artworks, the artists appreciated in value, and then we created actually also with help of Deloitte, an alternative investment fund manager in Luxembourg called Icona Collection that is now investing a lot of money into art, but into the primary art market. And here's something where we saw it's very important that profit needs purpose, but the purpose is not taken away from the profit, it can actually add to the profit. And we see here a big gap and a lost opportunity in the market that is the primary art market, so where really art market production happens, so where artists are producing works and not works that were produced, are recycled, where artists are not anymore participating. So this kind of financing the production of art and financing like new frontiers of art, that was for us extremely rewarding. And I was always saying that we are actually the ones that are benefiting most from this philanthropic engagement, much more probably. I mean, we are always receiving more than we are giving. And we have now, through this program, started also to work very, very close with artists and institutions, many institutions now that we are working with. And it became like a team that we somehow discovered that art is not only a kind of, you know, nice decoration, but it's really at the very, very core, unfortunately, of the problem of our society. So we are really at the core of the problem, because if we are looking back like 50,000 years, 20,000 years, 10,000 years, 5,000 years, our first settlements, this is all already cultural production. Our cultural production over the past 10,000 of years was able to produce so much anthropocenic mass. This is the mass that is basically concrete, asphalt, everything what humans are actually creating and building, that is that has exceeded in 2020 the biomass on the planet. So we started a whole research institute with the German government, with the Helmholtz Society, One Health, about it, and we see that there's a huge problem in our cultural production, because since thousands of years our cultural production is constantly transforming the living nature, biomass, into death matter that is not anymore participating in the metabolism of the planet. And now art and culture is the tipping point. It's basically the where everything is, trends are basically defined. So we started to work with a lot of artists that are on the forefront of a kind of new environmentally and socially engaged movement. For example, artists like Precious Okoyomon, like Refik Anadol, like Sumaya Bali, that are working with life and not with death matter. And it becomes really like suddenly something that we did as a philanthropy became a part of our core proposition also for cities, right? Because also cities need to be completely redesigned. And here we're talking about a trillion market, obviously. Cities are the most hostile environments that we have ever created for ourselves and for the planet. They have the much, you know, bigger, is by far like 80% environmental impact, cities and infrastructure. And the way how we actually transform the cities is decided at the top of cultural production. So it's the, you know, top architects, the top artists, the top designers, the top media that is writing about this. And we started to really form and participate at the core of this debate. And we believe that this is something that was for us the most rewarding, basically, learning curve at all, and we're very thankful for this.
So, Marco, it's to you.
Yes, I'm the director of Alberto Peruzzo Foundation that is based in Padova. For the non-Italians, it's a city half an hour from Venice, famous for the Scrovegni Chapel, the university, the Basil of St. Anthony, Basilica di Sant'Antonio. I have a past both in the institution and the art market. I worked for Christie's and for the Peggy Guggenheim Collection, for example. And I've been working for the foundation for the last 4 years. The foundation was established in 2015, but as a logical consequence of some cultural activities that started in 2011 by Alberto Peruzzo. The first big project was the restoration of the Venice Pavilion, the Giardini della Biennale, in collaboration with Louis Vuitton. And he fell in love with the rationalist pavilion, and he started from there. And the pavilion was opened with an exhibition by Fabrizio Plessi. Behind the foundation, there is an entrepreneurial group. In order of time, there is a printing company, because Alberto Peruzzo started as a typographer, is very passionate about the high-quality art books, and it's still going on with that. But but the leading company is a company that distributes energy, gas, and electricity, and then there is a shipyard also. We are committed in the dissemination of modern and contemporary art, but at the same time, the recovery of the artistic heritage. For example, the Venice Pavilion. And sometimes we use, in quotes, modern and contemporary art to enhance old buildings, historical buildings, less known by the people. For example, in 2018, we brought the cartoon by Picasso, Guernica. I don't know if you know that Picasso painted in the 50s a cartoon, Guernica, that is very similar to the painting. You know, in order to produce the tapestry that then went to the UN as a symbol of peace. We brought this cartoon to Palazzo Camerino in Padova, that is a beautiful building, but not so well known by the citizens. It was the home of Pietro Bembo, to celebrate the 100th anniversary of the signing of the armistice of the First World War between Italy and Austria that was signed in Padova. So we brought the cartoon also to get better known at the building and also to celebrate the armistice. Another example is in 2019, we brought an exhibition by Alberto Biasi to Palazzo Ferrofini in Venice, that is the home of Regione Veneto. That is a building of offices, not so well known by the citizens of Venice. So we try to match these kind of things. No? So this is the approach. And so now the big project we have been working with in the last 8 years, I started 4 years ago, but it started 8 years ago, is the restoration of a deconsecrated church in the historical center of Padova. It's a building of the 12th century. It took so long because of we found many archaeological finds, above all some fragments of frescoes of the Giotto school, and the Scrovegni chapel is just 1 kilometer from the church. So we have been studying it with the superintendents, with the university, but we are ready. We are almost there, and in January we are going to open the church. And the big challenge will be the dialogue between different historical periods. The church has a strange history because was sold to the privates after the Second World War and late in the 30s, and became a garage, a car repair place. We have some pictures of with old cars like Topolino parked inside the nave. That is quite strange. And then in the late 80s, it was closed. It was in decay. And so the big challenge is now to reopen and to do. And if you launch a kind of project like this, you need to collaborate with the local institutions, local societies, above all with the municipality, with the superintendents, that we have been still studying the fragments of frescoes and some other finds we found with the university, and also with the diocese, the diocese. Because inside the church there were some interesting paintings of the 17th century, and now we offer to restore one of them, and the diocese is going to give us in exchange on a long-term loan some paintings. One of them is by Gian Domenico Tiepolo. And so this is the challenge. But also we develop synergies with the printing company. As I said, Alberto Peruzzo, that is quite young, is 57 now, started as a typographer, and I still want to highlight the high-quality printing of art books. So we, for example, launched last year a collaboration with a university that is the second oldest in Europe, and this year the University of Padova is celebrating their 800th anniversary. For this reason, we launched the series Quaderni della Fondazione, Foundation Notebooks, with the monographic books. The first one is about Acunellis, that is in the courtyard of the university, and is quite special because it is one of the few public works that Acunellis decided to do. It's a symbol of freedom, 25 of April. And we restored the work and we produced the book. Another example is the production of another book about Elena Cornaro Piscopia, who is the first female graduate in history. She graduated in Padova in 1678, according to most at least. She graduated in philosophy, even if she wanted theology, but they told her that it was too much, so you can do philosophy. And we dedicated a book to Elena Cornaro Piscopia. That's it. So the big challenge is to collaborate from many different points of view with the local authorities and with the city, because the founder wanted to return something to the city and to create a place where, for example, most of the time we will not charge a ticket to get inside the church. So it's a place of meeting and exchange and a return to the city.
We have several examples on how to the advisory or the direct activity is directly contributing to the ecosystem. Now, I would like to approach the second question for which we have more or less 25 minutes, if I think it's correct. Bit less if possible, okay. And in which I would like to explore the essence of the panel, meaning due to the new environment in which we are developing activity of philanthropy, so measurement and attention to the ESG measurement in general, corporate social responsibility. Do you expect to have some change in your approach, on the approach that you are proposing to your clients, or do you expect to, or what do you are expecting it will occur for this? So I will again start with Monica.
Thank you. So I would say that this whole concept of social impact has absolutely influenced art philanthropy. I've been working with collector philanthropists for 20 years, and the kinds of things that they are asking now are very different from 20 years ago. So I'll just give some examples. So if someone wants to donate their collection to a museum, back in the old days, all they were focusing on was, am I going to get the wing named after me? How big is the plaque or the panel going to be? But now the questions that they're asking are very different. They're asking the museums, well, if I give you my collection, who is the audience that is going to benefit from this? If it's the same privileged, wealthy people that are already going to the museum, once a month as families, if they already have children that are in very good schools that have developed art programs, that's not of interest to me. So I will only give my collection to you if we also have a program in place so that we can have docents from the museum going to low-income and disadvantaged schools, so that we can pay for transportation for these children to come to the museums, so that we can provide free days when these children and their families can come to the museums. Because let's be honest, for most people in this world, they cannot afford a family of four. If you have to pay two adult, $25 or 25 euro per person entrance to go into a museum, that is unfortunately a luxury that most people cannot afford. We also see in the case of people who are deciding to create their own museums, they're asking very much, which community should we go to? Is there a community where we can actually, that's in need of revitalization, where if we bring our museum here, we can also attract other, you know, restaurants? Could we help with local employment by maybe having programs for internships or training programs so that some of the jobs in the museum, like the, you know, security guards and the people at the desk and the people in the museum bookshop and the restaurant, can those be people from that community so that we're doing something to help the ecosystem? Is there some local handicraft or type of, you know, art, whether it's, you know, textiles or, you know, woodworking, furniture making, something that we also local that we can incorporate into the museum? And even for those, you know, collector philanthropists who've decided to sell their collections, those sale proceeds are sitting in a bank account somewhere until they are deployed. And so instead of just deciding, well, we'll just put this in some regular type of you know, portfolio, we're actually, maybe we should be investing it in an ESG portfolio because that is more consistent and aligns better with the values and what these funds or have been you know, dedicated to. And I would say in terms of new frontiers, one thing that I actually do think, it was interesting listening to the metaverse panel, but I actually do think there is some potential there. Many of our clients are very concerned about education, especially after COVID. This younger generation, even though they were more connected online, in a way they disconnected from a lot of traditional ways of learning, which is very unfortunate. And so many people are thinking that perhaps the metaverse, and I'm, again, this is not a promotion for crypto or NFTs, but the technology of the metaverse that could potentially provide very engaging, immersive, educational experiences, that, you know, definitely could be, we could see some developments there. So there are actually, I'm aware of people who are actually deciding to set up museums in the metaverse, you know, art education institutions in the metaverse. But what they are doing is they are also seeking to get IRS, that's, you know, US Internal Revenue Service, 501c3 tax status, which would make them, you know, charitable entities. They would allow people donating to them to get tax deductions. And I think if they are successful doing that, I think especially on the part of the American, there's going to be a lot of interest in this and some, you know, potential possibilities. So.
Mm-hmm. So, Ernesto, to we wanted to have, and this year something happened, a flagship project to sparkle, if you want, this massive transformation of Generali into an ESG-driven business. And this is where art comes into place. Generali owns one of the most iconic buildings in the world, if we assume that Venice is one of the most iconic cities in the world. So if you picture St. Mark's Square in Venice and you're facing the Basilica, the church, on the right, on the left side, on the north side of the square, there is this massive building. It's a complex of over 130,000 square feet called the Procuratie Vecchie. This has been owned by Generali for over a century, and absurd to say, when I arrived in Generali 8 years ago, this building was empty and without a purpose, and it is one of the most iconic buildings of the world. So our mission was to restore the building and give it new life, but what we wanted to do is not just to have a beautiful piece of art and maybe just having an additional site for art exhibit in Venice, where we already have a lot. And this was a huge project. We thought that we need to give a content to the container, which is not the typical content you'd expect from such a building in Venice. So what we thought about was how we can showcase this transformation. So that was not just what encompassed the transformation itself, because it's a business transformation, but something that shows our commitment. So what we did was to consult all the employees in order to launch a foundation that then we created that doesn't have the name of Generali. The foundation is called the Human Safety Net. It's an open network that has two main objectives: to support refugees building an enterprise in the place where they arrive, and to support families in vulnerable conditions with children below 6 years of age, because science tells us that the brain is mostly formed in the first 6 years of age. And if the children do not receive the proper care, they will be at disadvantage for the rest of their lives. So we partnered with over 60 organizations around the world, and we started to support refugees on one side and families on the other side. In less than 5 years now, we have over 200,000 people that we have supported and more than 300 companies created in Europe. And much more we're doing in the countries that are adding time to time to this initiative. This is something that we come out with a conversation with our employees, 5,000 of them participated to define the mission of this new endeavor. Many of them provide voluntary work for this initiative, and we wanted to showcase this story into this new building. It was a 5 years renovation of the building. We invited great architects to present their projects. We involved David Chipperfield, Tadao Ando, Rem Koolhaas, Herzog de Meuron. Eventually was Sir David Chipperfield that was assigned to do the work. Now the building was born in the 1500 to host the procurators of the Republic of Venice, so those that would care about the finance of the Republic, but also to take care of vulnerable people, and has been basically without a mission for over 200 years since the end of the Republic of Venice. Now, as a new mission, which is aligned with the original mission, and what we put there is on the top floor of the building a place where we showcase the story of the foundation, but not just as the telling and narrative. There is an interactive exhibition on the potential of the human being, on the human being potential, which is kind of original in Venice, where art is the master play of the scene, but is in the context of the beauty. So it's where social and beauty and art come together, and it's really an experience where everybody can talk about its own potential. His or her own potential and understand what the contribution can be given to the society. And then the second floor of the building, again, is a massive complex, 130,000 square feet, has now started to be also home to art exhibitions. And the people that visit the place, they can contribute to the cause, and everybody that comes there like to contribute, and we give a feedback to the people on what the foundation is doing. So I think that this is a nice way, and we are having very good feedback where we can connect the mission of an insurance financial group, our venture philanthropy work, not just for what it does, but for what it means for the transformation, engagement of people, participation of people, and a fantastic platform to build alliances and to talk to institutions. So this is where I think we is a symbol, if you want, is the sparkle of this movement, where all these elements come together. And as I said before, I think it's now it must be in the DNA of businesses to have such an approach to society.
I can be short, I think, because we're a philanthropic institution, relatively small compared to the rest of the world. Our purpose is the S out of ESG, as I just mentioned. Environment, we are not so much involved in. We are involved in the park and in the other foundation. We do some refurbishments and more green into the city, but it's all small projects. And governance is, like I mentioned, we think we are properly governed and we do quite a bit of work on compliance ourselves, but we also try to improve governance and compliance in other institutions. But our whole purpose is ESG, and especially the S. I also use it, by the way, if I negotiate with advisors. I say, we're ESG, so if you give free advice, then you're allowed to mention our name.
Yes, so I give a specific example of a project that basically became like multi-layered. So when we purchased the Serpentine Pavilion of Sumaya Valley, we discovered her. She's the youngest actually architect that ever had the honor to create a Serpentine Pavilion. She is from South Africa with part of the Indian population there, and obviously she had to deal a lot also from her family history, and because it's South Africa, with displacement and different political basically situations. And when she created this pavilion, it's very interesting. It's a pavilion that is based on a completely different concept of architecture. It's not the architecture how we know it, like male dominated, like monumental, but it's an architecture that is very fluid and very about listening to the communities. And you know that in our cities, doesn't matter which European city, We have a situation where we have a new, you know, community with migration background that is not represented at all within the city, you know. So sometimes, like in Manchester, for example, where we also having a very big urban development project, this is a part of the population that, you know, that has a lot of different roots and a lot of history, but this history lives within, you know, the monuments of the past and is not represented there. So when we met Sumaya and she became like a very dear friend, we were like texting every day, and we developed a project. She actually proposed a project to our program that would create a community garden in Manchester based on the stories of the communities with migration background, planting trees into this trees and herbs and other plants that could become a new multifunctional space. This is another problem that is solved, because in our cities every space is a specific function, but actually in many, you know, other countries, spaces have many functions. So people can, you know, old people can meet in the evening, children can play during the day. And to recreate this kind of space, that we thought is a very good concept, a very good idea, so we commissioned her with this space. And suddenly, like, everybody in Manchester, all institutions, the mayor, the, you know, the galleries, everybody that had a free space wanted now to have the space and wanted to give us the land for free. This is how big the demand is for innovation and, you know, like, basically redesign. And then Tiny Temper, the quite famous British rapper, he did like a concert for the pavilion, for the closing of the Serpentine Pavilion last year at the opening of the Freeze Fair. And then he started to talk with Sumaya, and then there was a new project created, because he's coming originally from Lagos, where a whole center for migration communities, but not only migration communities, would be created with tiny funds. So his idea basically is, where I'm coming from, you only need like 200, 500, you know, like a small amount of money, and you need a space, and then you can actually, you know, kick off your career. So this is now a project that Sumaya is involved, that Tiny is involved, that Lagos is involved, that London is involved, and this is a kind of, you know, building community, but not, you know, we are trying not to put it on it, but like listening basically to the different protagonists and looking how it can become also sustainable and feasible over long term and being run by the protagonists of these communities. Yeah, so that's basically our short term.
So I think this morning, if I remember well, it was Valeria Brambilla who spoke about the power of culture in terms of bringing, promote social cohesion and inclusion, and also the impact on the well-being of people of the art, and we just need to think about the pandemic time and the lockdown. And this is the point where we started from when we decided to restore the church, because even if I think that during the lockdown, the focus was too much, but personally I think that it was too much on the consolatory role of art, but art can have also a more proactive and active role, for example, in dialogue with science and technology to help us to build our future, to have a vision. And so we need to balance those kind of things. But anyway, we started from there, and we think that a community needs places of identity, meeting and exchange, physical places. And historical buildings, and above all, if the buildings have used to have a spiritual function, have all the potentialities to be places like that. And we started from there, so we were speaking about the new frontier of our philanthropic activity. That is our new frontier, to develop a place of identity, meeting, exchange, where to promote inclusion, social cohesion, developing cultural and art activities. This is what we want to do.
So, I don't know if there are some questions. Adriano is very angry to...
Take one question, please.
Question. Yes. One question.
Yes. Okay. Okay, you have convinced them not to.
Let's move to the closing speech.
Okay. Now, of course. Thank you very much for your participation.